morals, because it's just contingent on whatever is the flavor of the day. So as an example, if we go back to, you said you were from which country again?
Ukraine.
Ukraine. So let's go back to Ukraine, say 50 years ago. Would you say there would be a big problem with people being anti-Semitic, right?
50 years ago.
50 years ago. And would you also say people back then had a, well, not 50s, let's say 70 years ago, during the height of the Soviet Union, that they had morals which you would today find very problematic? I think it's safe to say that, right? And their ideas on human rights collectively would be very different to the sort of ideas that you have today. Now, if you have your ideas and Ukrainians have their ideas, then from your perspective, how can you tell this one's true and this one's false? How can you adjudicate between the two? And the revelation from God, if something comes from God and God knows everything, then that thing is going to be objectively true. But in your case, it's just going to change according to the flavors, the trends, and the passions, and the desires of the populace at a particular time.
Yeah. I tell you what, I see for myself, at least, a way of judging which cultures and which ideas are better than others. It's a relation between cost and reward. You know,
let me get off. Yeah, Karim.
Everything that you do, everything you, all the moves that you make in the society have a cost and a reward. You know, for example, conquest. You expand your empire, you conquer other people. There's a cost. There's going to be suffering. There's going to be deaths. There's going to be, abhorrent things happening. But if the reward of that society is to create a great civilization that will eventually make the lives of the people better, that will make humanity move forward, then the reward outweighs the cost in this way. Now, for example, if we look at a specific culture, you know, Carthage. Carthage had a religious practice of child prostitution,
right,
and the child sacrifice. It was not a positive cost-reward relation, because sacrificing children is such a big cost to take, such a great and abhorrent action to make, that the reward to outweigh that is simply unachievable to humans, I would say. So we can tell, we can judge things with cost and reward. We can see what it took to achieve that.
Yeah.
We can see the achievement and we can make the judgment.
Okay, so that perspective, that's a utilitarian way of looking at things. So what you're doing is you're looking at the maximum happiness and the minimum amount of suffering. Right? The maximum benefits and the minimum amount of pain. Now the problem with that perspective is we can see scenarios in which if we change the variables, we'll have totally different moral outcomes. So for example, if you have someone recently, I'll give you an example. Recently, there was a case where a woman was raped on a motorway, right? She was in the motorway, she got raped. And there was a few people involved in her rape. Now from a utilitarian point of view, if you look at that thing, you have people maximizing their pleasure and one person who's going through pain. So if we look at maximization of pleasure and minimizing of pain, then from that perspective, that would be the morally right thing to do. Conversely, say right now, I'm sure you can touch and you can feel, but say if you were someone who felt no pain, right? You actually didn't have pain receptors, you had some sort of malfunctioning, then killing you would not be morally wrong in any way, because it would give me pleasure and you would not feel any sort of pain. So this utilitarian way of looking at things, one, it doesn't give you an objective standard, two, it gives you absurd results, and three, there's no way of adjudicating between two different scenarios with different moral variables.
Tell you what, I'm not exactly a utilitarian.
Okay.
Because as you said, it's as you said, utilitarians put feeling good, you know, pleasure as the pinnacle. I put having a future as a pinnacle. You know, the existence of the species requires that people feel some pleasure, because if people exist in perpetual pain, it reduces their possibility of survival.
Right.
So I think pain receptors themselves, I think we can agree on that. I mean, maybe not, because I would say it's a trait that was developed through evolution and epigenetics, because pain is useful for us to understand where we are getting destroyed and to prevent ourselves from being destroyed, you know?
Sure.
The example you gave about multiple men raping a woman. Yeah, indeed. The man will feel pleasure, the woman...
Would you agree from a utilitarian point of view, you can't disagree against the argument then?
I can. because you're ignoring all the other people of the equation. If we allow certain men to rape a woman, yes, the group of men is more than one woman, but the whole society will suffer an exponentially bigger threat because of that. It's going to remove the taboo of raping women. It's going to be the rule of the strong, not the rule of the clever, not the rule of the one who knows how to rule. It's going to be the rule of the ones who holds bigger strength, you know?
Sure. So what you're saying is, if you, this is a classical defense, right? So what you're doing, what you're saying is, if you take that example and you apply it to society, then overall you're going to have more pain than pleasure. However, that's assuming that firstly other people find out about the rape, because they could just kill her and get rid of the body.
Yeah, they could.
Secondly, that's also assuming that there's more moral good than bad in society, because you could have a society where it's kind of like, they, and there are some societies in the world in which toxic type of behavior against women is more prevalent than others. So this is assuming, all things being equal, that you would have this outcome. But if we change the variables again, the scenario changes again and it gives us different outcomes. So what I'm trying to get to is this. If we look at the utilitarian point of view, or you're saying your view is slightly different because you're looking at the the survival of the lineage of the group of populations rather than
the species,
you could say. Okay, the problem with that is, from a purely biological point of view, if man was red in tooth and claw and our lives were short and brutish, you know, the Hobbesian viewpoint, how do you get from that? Because it's a wonderful idea that we care about species. It's a wonderful idea. But what I'm asking for is, under your worldview, how is it actually grounded? Because I would agree with you. Because let's just do this. Let's get rid of utilitarianism. Let's agree the survival of the species is best. But does that fit under a agnostic worldview?
Yes. Okay. It fits even, I would say, under an individualistic view, which is mine. I have a selfish view. I do what I do for my own benefit. I'm not gonna lie, I'm not doing it for, you know, mumbo-jumbo, nice, goody-two-shoes reasons. But there's an understanding that if you help society, society is gonna help you. If you make society prosper, if you make society great, and if you make humanity great, it's going to be better for you. Because humanity, you know, it's an exchange of goods between different humans. I'm doing it for myself in the end. But doing it for myself doesn't negate the fact that it's in my interest to help the others. You know what I mean?
So
it's a simple understanding that I think it's very important for people to have.
That the world is utilitarian, not necessarily, regardless, you're saying it is utilitarian, rather than it's taken a conscious utilitarian.
I'm saying it's just logical.
There is that, and what you're basically describing is, you're describing inclusive fitness. So essentially, all good can be broken down to kin selection, which is, if you're, or kin selection of reciprocal altruism. So you're good to someone because they're going to be good to you eventually, or you're good to someone because they carry your genes, right? And according to some theorists, this is where good comes from. The problem, however, there is that the idea that good only comes from this type of reductive bottom-up approach doesn't explain good actions that we do for which we are not reciprocated, and good actions that we do that don't benefit our inclusive fitness in terms of kin selection. So for example, when you help out somebody and you give charity, most of the time today, charity is anonymous. The person that you're giving money to, he could be a free rider. And free riders could take over society, and society would be destroyed, right? So again, we're in the same dilemma, because your worldview at the moment, at best, it's a great idea, survival of the species, but in terms of grounding it...
Yeah, people don't think about it.
Sorry?
People don't think about it.
You're right, they don't think about it.
They don't think about it, yeah.
They like the idea, they don't think about where it's grounded.
I would justify that with this, because at this point, it's not only a mental conclusion. At this point, it's a genetic trait. We spoke about this last time. You remember the example I gave about the caveman and the wolves, blah, blah, blah. The cavemen who helped the others, they kept living because they helped each other. It doesn't need to happen in your head. The conclusion doesn't need to happen in your head.
The thing is,
it's something genetic. And let me just say one more thing. That's where psychopaths come into play. Because psychopathy is from birth. It's not earned. Sociopathy is earned with time, from big stress through life. Psychopathy is something that comes from birth. And simply put, psychopathy is the deviation from this gene of altruism, you know, of helping others. The deviation of it. psychopaths, they sometimes are successful, because I would say that psychopaths eventually develop this gene of deceit, of deceiving others for their own benefit, you know? But mostly, I would say, psychopaths are not clever enough to hide their real agenda, their real desires, so they simply get removed by evolution, by epigenetics. They simply can't coexist with humans, because other humans see they won't get anything in return from helping them, you know? So it's something genetic, basic genetics in people.
You see, that, if you say it's purely genetic, that creates another line of problems.
This example that you gave, I'm just mentioning this example.
Sure, but look,
you're doing anonymous.
Okay, so let's extrapolate all the possibilities. So there's a genetic element, there's an epigenetic element in which the environment induces a gene switch. There is a behavioral element in terms of your behavior giving you adaptive advantages. And there's a symbolic or cultural element in terms of the culture, right? So that's evolution in four dimensions. Okay, the problem, however, is you're still back to the same issue, which is only under certain conditions will it give you the outcome that we're actually looking for. Because there's many, many scenarios in which kin selection, reciprocal altruism, and even if you say a type of altruism is a byproduct of this, it still gives you a lot of limitation on human nature. Which is why I take the view that the bottom-down reductive view of human nature does not fit what we actually see in the real world. And that's why I don't agree with Darwinism, because I don't think it can explain much of human behavior.
Well, again, as we
society, you don't think it can explain society?
I don't think it can explain more than the aspects of society which fit into reciprocal relationships or things that help our inclusive fitness. I think those are the only aspects it explains, and it doesn't explain a large part of what we would call human nature.
The human nature itself is flawed, so the logic that humans have to exist is necessarily also, in a way, flawed. It's not what I'm saying.
What do you
is
mean by
perfect.
Flawed?
It's not foolproof.
What do you mean by human nature is flawed?
Well, simply put, humans don't know things with absolution, with the absolute certainty. They have approximations, right? We have approximations that make valid conclusions, right?
Right.
You know, as David Hume, he divides knowledge into three categories. You probably know about this, but let me just say it for the rest of the people. You know, it's first of them is matters of fact. Relations of ideas, yeah. It's basically 1 plus 1 equals 2, a triangle has three sides, the denial of which leads to self-contradiction. The second one is matters of fact. For example, I'm standing right here near you. I'm standing right here with these guys, you know, we can speak, we can see each other, we can touch each other. It's dependent on our senses, and thus it's flawed just like our senses, you know. For example,
secondary properties.
Yes, you know. If I am, for example, daltonic, then me seeing everybody, all of you around, is not exactly the same way as you see the other people around. So senses flawed. And the third one is observed regularities, and it's the most flawed of all because it's predictions for the future. And that's what we're doing here. You know, we're talking about valid ways of humans organizing themselves in a society. I base myself not on the Quran, not on the Bible. I base myself on history. That's the most basic thing that I base my knowledge on. I see what has functioned through the course of history. I see how people, the problems that people have had, and the solutions they came up with, and the success or lack of. And I make a conclusion, this is better than this. For example, you know, if a country is in big strife, it's getting attacked, it's getting wrecked by other countries, it needs something. Then in that case, you know, a totalitarian government for that country might actually be useful for them to defend themselves. Because that's how you get shit done quickly, right? That's how you get things done, you know, immediately. Because you need to react fast. But in times of peace, it's not that great. Because as you know, absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Yep.
And eventually the government becomes corrupt. You know what I mean? So two different ideologies. You know, usually we say, oh, totalitarianism, it's evil. It's bad for times of peace. But for times where you're getting slaughtered, where you're getting killed, it's either kill or be killed.
Would you say you learning more history, or us learning more history, is going to give us those lessons that we need to make us better?
I'm very certain of that.
Okay, so the problem I have with that alone is you can't go from what is out there to what we should be doing. That would be the naturalistic fallacy. So this has happened. if this happened, then this happened. And historically, if, say, for example, if Hitler did not invade Russia, Soviet Union, and instead he just concentrated on the Western Front, he probably would have won the war. So, you know, knowing all these contingencies, we can't go from is to this is what we ought to do. So the problem I have with this perspective is, no matter how much knowledge we gain, we will not know what to do. At best, we know what has happened.
I disagree. I think we will know the probability of what might work. You know, for example, Hitler started the war on two fronts, right? But at the same time, you know, the situation is very complex, especially in Hitler, because he didn't have resources, he needed to act fast, he needed to do blitzkrieg to take over the world, basically. It was a losing situation from the very beginning. They were practically doomed. It's already strange how the Germans did so well at the war. Personally, I find it strange. But mostly it's because Stalin killed all the good generals in the Soviet Union, so they started getting slaughtered by the thousands. It's all because of Stalin, basically, that the war went so badly for the Soviet Union. But it was much more powerful than Germany, so they still won. No. But what we can learn from this, for example, is that if you start a war on two fronts, there's a bigger likelihood that you'll lose the war, you know?
Yeah, but all you're going to do is you're going to help a 21st century warlord how not to make mistakes of the past.
Not necessarily. Because look, if you are facing Hitler in a war, you need to know the same lessons that you can learn with Hitler. You know, you learn with everyone, even with your enemy. I would say especially with your enemy. Hitler made a mistake, and you learn with that mistake. So, for example, imagine...
The mistake was losing, but
The mistake was opening two fronts,
yeah, I would say. But that will give you nothing about the moral... the moral color of what he did that was wrong, and the way that you know, he persecuted the Jews. I mean, all those things are going to be...
But we're not talking about that.
So how can we speak about right or wrong, though?
Okay. Now we're talking just about war. Win-lose, right? We're omitting morality here. Because war, let's face it, war has no morality.
I don't agree with that.
It's blood, tears, and shit. There's no beauty in war.
There's no beauty in war, but there are morals. There are moral imperatives. There are rights. There are wrongs. There's laws of... What do they call them? Just war theory?
These days, look, people basically have accepted certain rules so they won't destroy themselves. It's a basic rule of self-preservation, right? There's no actual rule, but they will try to maintain those rules. So, because, look, imagine this. Imagine you're fighting against an army and you have a big victory. You capture a million prisoners, a million soldiers, and you kill them all because you want to win the war. Next battle... You get a million soldiers captured and they get all killed, right? Or 2 million and they get all killed. It's a very destructive path. It's a very risky path, you know? So it's better to go, you know, the more lenient way.
About morality,
killing the Jews, all of that stuff. I would say we can logically assert that it's not a good way to go either. Because, you know, for example, many of the German scientists were Jews. The Germans, you know, I have a personal theory that Hitler hated the Jews mainly because they were competition to him. They were competition to his ideology, to his, you know, how should I say, to his strive for power. You know, Hitler actually borrowed some money from the Jews and he eventually turned on them so he wouldn't give it back. He made the Jews the boogeyman.
If he took the advice from history, if he could see into the future, he'd just be a worse person, because he'd use the Jews to conquer and he'd do different things.
There's one thing I think that Hitler, if he considered, he didn't pay too much attention to. I don't think he paid enough attention to this. It's that, it's what we said before, you know. You do something to somebody else, you are ruthless to somebody else, they'll be ruthless back at you. It's exchange, basically. Hitler had the idea of Aryan supremacy. He thought they could win against all odds. They couldn't. They lost. Hitler made a gamble based on a misplaced ideology, basically. He thought he was superior, but he wasn't. And he was ruthless because he thought he was superior. But now the main thing, now the main point of this whole situation is, if you kill people based on their ethnicity, it removes a very important taboo. Because it basically allows for witch hunts inside of your own ranks. You know, for the perfect example is the social justice warriors nowadays. You know the TERFs over there, the feminists who are against trans people. The perfect example of social justice warriors fighting social justice warriors.
I didn't know. Are they down there?
They're left already. I think they've already left. But look, basically, they are judging people based on their ideology. If you disagree with us, you're not, you're a Nazi, you're evil, you're this, you're that, you're that. And they started the same witch hunt in their own ranks. It's a destructive ideology from the very beginning, because it's very extremist in its very, to its very core. Same with religious extremism, you know? You become a religious extremist, let's imagine this, during the Spanish Inquisition. Sure, you will have a lot of power over the people, blah, 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 but then eventually, if somebody has a little bit more power or influence, they can say, he's a heretic, and that's it, you get burned at the stake. That's why I don't like mob rule, you know, mob justice. It's very volatile, it's very volatile. One day you're ruling the mob, the next day you're getting burned by the mob.
Yeah, but again, we're back to the...
I was going to just come back to...
It's just not functional, it's just not logical.
Come back to the...